today, the Democratic Party in the United States has their work cut out for them.
That's right. If you take a look at this map, the red is where the Republican Party controls state houses across the country after the 2016 elections.
And that is a lot of red. How will the Democrats rebuild? I'm Femi Okeh.
I'm Malika Bilal, and you're in the stream. The Democrats have chosen a new leader.
Mr. Tom Perez.
Establishment candidate and former labor secretary under President Obama, Tom Perez. He beat the party's more liberal candidate, Minnesota Congressman Keith Ellison. In an unusually closely watched race, many saw the contest as an indicator of what direction the party would go as it rebuilds after a calamitous defeat last year.
We need to make house calls. We need to listen to people. We need to get back to basics. I know we will win the battles ahead when we put our values forward, when we lead together, when we mobilize this grassroots energy.
Democrats have lost nearly 1,000 state seats in the last 8 years, but the election of Donald Trump has created a wave of grassroots activity across the country in response. So how will the party unite? Can the leadership bring the growing populist movement into the fold? With us to talk about all of this, here in our studio, Malcolm Kenyatta. He's a community advocate, a longtime Hillary Clinton supporter. In Springfield, Ohio, Samuel Ronan just returned from the DNC race, where he was running for chairman. And in New York City, Noma Key Const is an investigative reporter with the Young Turks. It's good to have you here, everybody. Sam.
It's glad to be here.
Yes, it's great to have you. So, Sam, if you were going to take the temperature of the DNC right now, would it be healthy, ailing? What kind of a state would the health of the DNC be in?
See, unfortunately, the DNC made a very big mistake. What they did is they spoke unequivocally and decided that they do not want outside involvement within the party. They don't want a resurgence. They don't want a regrowth. And so I would say it's in very much so unhealthy status right now.
I don't want to drive
the conversation here, but I think most people can agree that with the populist movement being what it is, it hasn't been embraced by the party. So where does it come into play now?
Malcolm?
I don't know. I would disagree. I think that we see a party that needs to continue this process of uniting. The first thing that Tom Perez, who was just made the DNC party leader, did was bring in his former rival Keith Ellison as a deputy chair of the party. I think that that was a powerful statement, but also a powerful opportunity, right, for the party to unite around grassroots ideas. And Keith Ellison said it very clearly. If you supported me, if you believed in me, I now need you to believe in Tom and get on board with Tom and get on board with moving our party to focusing on, which I think is the real issue, and that's stopping Donald Trump.
And unfortunately, I don't disagree with the sentiment. I understand and see completely why bringing Keith would be a catalyzing agent to bringing everyone on board. And I think Nomi would be able to weigh in on this one as well. The problem is people aren't buying it. People don't believe it. People don't see it as such. And unfortunately, even with the Bernie Sanders movement, the Tulsi Gabbard, Nina Turner, even myself, I even said I'd be happy to support Tom Perez, but I'd hold his feet to the fire. That does not mean that we still didn't lose millions of Democrats immediately after Tom Perez's election.
I don't know. I don't think that that's what happened. But
so I actually want to share one person's point of view, because you said you're not sure that's what happened. Sam, you said that is what happened. So this is Stefan. This is Stefan on Twitter. He says, the DNC is dead to me and to most thinking leftists. Only the self-serving and the deluded still believe in that party. On the other hand, though, maybe a more moderate view. This is someone's name, their handle is The Resistance, who says the Democrats are a big tent and no one on the left spectrum is actively being prevented from being involved. So pushing back against that earlier tweet, Noma Key, what do you make of that? Does this describe the state of the Democratic Party right now?
Yeah, I think that the conversation the media has characterized this race as is actually what's flawed. It's not the Hillary Clinton Obama wing versus the Bernie Sanders wing. It really is not. And Bernie Sanders, of course, ran for president in a primary as a leftist against Hillary Clinton. And a lot of those voters, the Bernie Sanders voters, felt like the process wasn't fair. And we now know through WikiLeaks and we know through FEC filings, the elections monitoring, that indeed the DNC was working with Hillary Clinton. That's indisputable. But with that being said, the Democratic Party went into this process with one purpose and one purpose alone, to rebrand itself. You know, when I polled DNC members who are split, by the way, these are members who have been active in their community for a long time. These aren't millennials for the most part. These are people who've been around. The average age is around 6 years old. They've been in the party for a long time, and they feel like the national party has neglected the states, that old federal versus states' rights thing, that debate. So, you know, the branding that the DNC had to do in this open process, what Donna Brazile, the chair of the Democratic National Committee, billed as the most transparent process in the history of the Democratic Party, what they had to do was restore the faith. Now, you know, I went to every single forum, saw Sam there at all of them, did probably the most coverage of the DNC race, and I can tell you that when the DNC, on the day of the voting, did not follow its own bylaws, which has been reported, meaning they didn't make the votes public because secret ballots are illegal, that alone is an indication that they're not understanding how serious this is. So right. So
let me share something here. Malcolm, I'm going through your tweets here. Tom Perez is the new chairman of the @DNC. I'm ready to unite and fight. What are you uniting?
So I think that we had, and obviously, when we have these conversations about the DNC, it always feels like we're rehashing the primary between Hillary and Bernie.
I'm getting flashbacks.
Exactly. And I think that this was, for a lot of people, people wanted to make it a proxy war. They wanted to make it another primary. And so Keith Ellison was endorsed by Bernie, so thereby he was the most progressive candidate. Tom Perez was had the support of Vice President Biden, former Vice President Biden, and so thereby he was the establishment candidate. But the fact of the matter is they both had support from the establishment wing, that terminology I don't really like, and also people that are newer to the party.
So
and you're talking about an open party,
united?
An independent ran for
been...
our nomination.
All right, so you
so
would...
that's open.
Right. Can I just push back on that? Mm. For the record, and again, I've reported on this, Tom Perez didn't have any Bernie Sanders support. He didn't have one endorsement by a Bernie Sanders ring. So,
he had endorsements by progressive leaders.
No, he did.
Leaders.
Not.
He
not
did.
By anybody.
And Keith Ellison was
Malcolm.
Also endorsed
by
Schumer.
No, me and Malcolm. What does it matter today? What are you trying to? What are you trying to unite?
Tom Perez, the point about Tom Perez
being the unity candidate is, if Tom Perez doesn't have the left wing, how could he be the unity candidate? Whereas Ellison did actually have.
Yes, you're living in the past.
But I don't want to bring this up. Who are you calling the left wing at this
yes,
point?
Yes, please, Sam.
This is, I think, where we keep getting cut off. You see, right here, Nomi is like absolutely like, right, boom, we got the left. And then you got, you know, I'm sorry, I'm terrible with
Malcolm.
Got you. Malcolm, sorry. Wow.
No, that's fine. It's a good name. I'll repeat it.
4 weeks. Malcolm, you're not establishment or anything, but you're saying like, look, this is the opportunity. And I agree, there is an opportunity to grow. The problem is perception. And I mentioned that since day one in Houston, that the perception isn't there. And unfortunately for many people feel that because they voted against Resolution 33, which was the quintessential opportunity to vote money, corporate money, lobbyist money, out of the DNC, when that didn't happen, that was the final straw, right? And Tom Perez, yes, he has a progressive ideology. He wants to unite us. He said all the things. He even started, his message started to shift more along the lines of what people wanted to hear. Mm. So with
Sam,
that,
DNC chair. What was your platform? How did you want people to take you seriously as a potential leader of the DNC? What could you offer?
Well, what I was offering was this whole aspect of inclusivity. If the problem is people don't have a say and people don't have a voice and people don't know how to get involved, case in point, I had no idea how to get involved. And when I went to the Democrats.org website, there was no information. I couldn't find a call list. I couldn't find a how-to, anything. My whole thing was to make the process simpler and more inclusive. And really, all it takes is a directory and a one-on-one guide how to run for the Democratic chair or state chair or whatever. How do you get involved? The second thing I brought up was the fact that everybody wanted to talk about the 50-state strategy, which is all well and dandy.
And 50-state strategy for people watching around the world is?
I'm sorry. Yeah, the 50-state strategy is there's 50 states in the United States of America. There's seven territories. But the ones who get to vote for president are the 50 states, right? So if you don't have a presence in your state, you're obviously not going to have a presence as a party, which means your people aren't going to get elected. But more importantly than that, and I think more definitively, is the local races. If you don't have a local presence, especially in rural America, so the farming communities, the poorer communities, the less or the more sparsely populated communities in the country, if you don't have a presence there, then you're not going to win in those locations, which means you're not going to win in the state, which ultimately hurts you at the federal level. So as a party, we have lost touch of where we stand.
And I think that what you're saying, Sam, is right. What happens at a local level is so much more important than who the DNC chair is. The DNC chair, right, in a lot of cases, is the person that we'll see on the Sunday shows, and I think it's very powerful. It's the person that will help to craft where are we spending our resources. But at the end of the day, we have to worry about what's happening with local chairs of local state parties. That's what's important. And I think that one thing that gets lost in all this ideological hoopla is real people that are affected by the policies that are coming out of the current administration. And right, we really missed an opportunity when we didn't, yeah, when we didn't elect the Democratic nominee and then continue to push that administration as we should. Push that administration to be responsive to the people.
It makes sense
in real people's lives.
Well, it does as rhetoric, but what that means fundamentally is the DNC chair is incredibly powerful. They unilaterally decide how to spend the money that goes into the budget, how much money goes to the state level.
And you know well that party money has been dwindling.
Please let Naomi finish because I think she's going to hit it nice.
Okay. This reporting is, you know, what I was trying to get to. It's not left versus right. It's about states not having the funding to go and organize at the local level. Some of these states said that they had $100 in their accounts. No wonder they lost 1,000 seats. So when Secretary Perez was being supported, when you look at the budget, which was not transparent, by the way, and I had to go back and do the back math, do you know where the majority of the money was spent? Over $1 billion was spent on national consultants that lost candidates' elections. And what's really important to note, and this is why it's important to talk about this race, is that Secretary Perez, now Chairman Perez, was being supported by these consultants. They were fundraising for him so that he kept the budget the same way. So yes, there's this transformation, and Chairman Perez wants unity, and he brings Keith Ellison up as a symbol. But how is he going to change that budget when everybody supporting him wants the status quo?
And so, Naomi, I'm really glad that you mentioned that the consultants. I want to bring in that point here, because we got a Facebook comment from Lola. She says what needs to happen is stop taking money from lobbyists would be a good start, and get rid of these expensive quote-unquote consultants and help Democrats in all 50 states. That pretty much rounds up what you are saying. But there's also a comment here from someone out of San Diego. His name is Trevor Hill, and this is his recommendation for what needs to happen.
Hi, guys. Thanks so much for taking my comment. My recommendation would be for the Democratic Party to stop focusing so much on rhetoric when it comes to their economic message and focusing more on actual policies on the Senate floor that they're fighting for that would actually benefit working class Americans. Things like a higher minimum wage, things like easier access to a union. People want to see real tangible results, and the Democrats aren't offering that.
So Malcolm, as he was, as that video was playing, so Sam was clapping his hands, Naomi Key was nodding her head.
And I am in agreement. And I think that is what we should do. I think that the issue is we've been having like this philosophical conversation and not a practical conversation about real people's lives. So I think we all agree. Let's focus on raising the minimum wage, and let's just stop throwing out these terms that I think are used to silence debate from some that consider themselves on the left, to say that you're corporate, you're establishment, thereby what you're saying is wrong. As a black, poor, gay kid growing up in North Philly, I mean, I think I understand what people in their real lives are focusing on. They're caring about who raises the minimum wage. They're caring about access to a union, as he said. They're caring about making sure Donald Trump and Republicans don't strip their health care. They really do not care a lot about who is the DNC chair. They don't care at all.
That's actually
and I don't think it matters, and that's the conversation we should have.
We need to be focusing actual resources and people. So Take my own state representative campaign, for example. I went to my county chair. Now, it through no fault of their own, they did not have the resources. They didn't have the money. They didn't have the contacts with local news networks or newspapers. They simply didn't have it. In fact, the majority of people who were there were the same Democrats that were in that party for 30 or 40 years. Yeah. There's no youth. There's no ground game. There's no recruitment because it simply can't exist. We're talking about rural America. That's why I brought it up. For 30 years, we have not had a presence in the United States in the rural areas. We've only been present in urban areas and metropolitan areas. And great, that's all well and good. L.A. is an amazing place to go. San Diego, friggin' New York City, all these big cities, that's perfect. Those are Democratic strongholds, and we saw that in the map. But the rest of the country was blood red, and that's the issue. It's not enough to say we need to do it. We should be physically doing it. When I ran for state representative, I went to the ODP since I couldn't, you know, it's just like the military, right? You go to the lowest level, supervisor, next level, commander, boom. So I went to the ODP to ask them for their help, and they told me point blank, verbatim, we are only going to support the top six candidates, the top six, not six who whatever, the top six, meaning the six that we're going to win with or without.
Sam, tell me why this isn't a story about you, and it's a story about strategy. What could be a better Democratic strategy moving forward?
Absolutely. And this is the funny thing, right? I'm 27 years old. I was in the military literally 2 years ago. I mean, I was literally active duty. Now I'm in politics.
Thank you for your service, Sam, by the way.
Oh, no, that's not why I bring it up. I bring it up because I have zero background in this, right? Mm. And even I can understand that what we're fundamentally lacking is this teamwork, this cohesion. The military, and I like bringing up the military structure because whether you're an E1 or you're the chief of staff of the armed forces, mm-hmm. you know your spot. You know, even though you have four stars on your shoulder, you play a role, not the entirety of everything. The Democratic Party needs to embrace something along those lines. The county chair should be facilitating and mentoring a group of people to either run for office, facilitate fundraising, facilitate recruitment, etc.
Okay.
There is none of that structure.
And I think maybe we're more united than we think. I think I agree.
Well, and actually, an interesting point about that.
Let me show you this, because we've got so much to talk about in this program. Indivisible, a practical guide for resisting the Trump agenda.
Yes.
I am thinking, Nomi, about grassroots and activism. Are you seeing that as part of a new Democratic strategy? What's going on?
Well, this was debated extensively at the DNC, not just for the chairs, but there were the vice chairs who talked about this, mm-hmm. about how they can work with these activist organizations. The reality is, and Sam just brought this up, that these local parties, they don't have the resources, and they don't have... Some of it's a cultural issue, too. They've just been doing things the same way for decades. And then also the DNC members, literally, the first time they ever had anything to do was to vote for the chair. These are people who got elected as DNC members, and they're just invited to fancy, elaborate fundraisers. So why, you know, what this has to do with grassroots is really important, right?
It's true,
if
though.
The corporate, you know, if you want to go back to the communities and you want to fight for the person who's a union member, or you want to fight for 15, it's really hard to do that when you're accepting money from the interests that are fighting against that. So,
can you say,
you know, I go
louder?
Out there, it's really hard to go and fight for some people that want improved rights, improved economic security, $15 minimum wage and up, equal pay, when the interests that are fighting against that are paying your bills. And so
and
that is why corporate money
perception.
Is important. And it goes against the perception. So grassroots organizations out there, I think what's happened is they've lost a place in the Democratic Party. And my dear friends at Indivisible, my dear friends who are Black Lives Matter, the ones that I go out there and I cover when I'm not covering the Democratic Party, are complaining that the Democratic Party's dead, that they're not going to get changed by running for office. So I think the DNC and Chairman Perez needs to understand that this is something that is not going to happen through emails asking for donations. The emails that they should be sending out are, hey, there's an event, there's a protest happening on the corner over here against Uber. There's a protest happening out here in front of Verizon. And we're organizing CWA and all these different organizations, Indivisible, so you should come out.
Nomi, you mentioned Indivisible, and we showed that page, and I want our audience to know, of course, who that is. And so it's a group of former congressional staffers who are working to push against the Trump agenda, as they say, and that's what their website says. We actually heard from an organizer of Indivisible, possible. This is his comment on strategies moving forward. This is Gonzalo.
We borrowed a couple of tactics from what we saw the Tea Party did to the Obama administration back in the year 2009, when Obama came to Washington with a historic mandate with a supermajority in Congress. He was nonetheless challenged at every turn by a vocal minority that called themselves the Tea Party. We know that if the vocal majority that is opposed to the Trump agenda, the folks that we've seen at the Women's March, the folks that we've seen come out to the airports during the first iteration of the Muslim ban, if they band together and begin to focus on their individual members of Congress, they will effectively stop the Trump agenda.
So Tea Party tactics, Malcolm, do you think that that is what we are seeing right now? A group of people who are disgruntled at their party and are taking it into their own hands to push up against their elected officials?
Well, absolutely. And so, and I have been in I've been at a number of the rallies and helped organize a bunch of them, and I'm going to do it every single day. So I know Donald Trump likes to watch TV, and he should know that we're not going away, that we're going to have something to say about his horrific agenda every single day, every step of the way. And what I think you see is patriotism. I wouldn't call it Tea Party or anything else. You see patriotism. You see people that love their country, that loves what this country can and should stand for, and believe that Donald Trump and his anti-immigrant, anti-women, anti-everybody that is not a white cisgender male, those policies do not represent our country. And so you see us doing what we ought to do when fascism rolls around. We're going to fight back. We have a duty to fight back. We have a responsibility to fight back. The people in our communities, our parents, our families, our neighbors, our friends, they need us to fight back. The 22-year-old dreamer who spoke out in Mississippi just the other day about his horrific deportation policies that was just deported. They're going to need people to fight back. And so the Tea Party, I don't think they had good ideas, but they understood that if you have a message, you have to hold firm to it, and you have to be willing to get out there every single day. And I do see that in a way that I don't think we've ever seen before in this country.
And you're right. And that goes back to the civic engagement. So what I was bringing up was what the Democratic Party needs to do, and what I was suggesting we do, is get people on board. Give them something to fight for, not necessarily against. And I'm looking at the camera now. So in either case, though, it's about getting people civically engaged. And whether that's activism, whether that's fundraising, whether that's within the Democratic Party or the Republican Party. Here's the thing. In rural America, the Democratic Party does not exist. It does not have strength. It does not have an influence. So be a dark horse candidate on the Republican Party. The thing that I'm doing now, people keep asking me, Samuel, what are you doing now that you're not running for the DNC chair? I am trying to bring together every single progressive and activist movement in the country under one collaborative umbrella so that while we're doing these hundreds of things in parallel, but not together, we can focus our efforts and unite forward. And honestly, Malcolm, when this is over, reach out to me. My email, well, I guess I probably shouldn't say
it on here. We have some work to do.
We do, right. And I want to work with you because here's the thing. You already have activism. You already have organizational skills. Nomi is a part of the Young Turks. She has organizational skills. You know, all of these different groups and these efforts need to start working together. It's not about Justice Stems. It's not about Black Lives Matter. It's not about all these individual things. It's about coming together. Black Lives Matter cannot win by itself. Neither can the Women's March. Neither can the No Ban, No Wall. Neither can DAPL. But if we start working together, regardless of Democratic or Republican or all this BS partisanship, if we, the people, the 42% that aren't affiliated, start voting for our interests and running on our principles and voting for our needs, we win. And that's what I'm saying.
Sam and Malcolm, you both can speak the heck out of this show, but I'm going to ask you just to take a pause for a moment because I'm going to take all of you online. We're going to carry on this conversation in our post show at stream.aljazeera.com. You can exchange your details then later. But for now, Malika, what do you have for us?
I'll end with this tweet from Bethany, who says, the Democrats need to go to the people who are against them and listen. The rest of us don't need affirmation. Go to the people, listen.
You will find Malcolm, Sam, Nomi, myself, and Malika online at stream.aljazeera.com. Thanks for watching. See you soon. picking up right where we left off, which is the DNC. What does it do now? How does it rebuild, regroup, strategize? Wow, that is a big conversation. I want to get your instant reaction, guess. Have a look at this picture on my laptop, and then you all instantly react. There you go. What do you think when you see that, Nomi?
I was there. It was a little tense in the room. I mean, I think, maybe I'm the realist here, but that's my job. I was in the room, and it was moments after the defeat. It's going to be a lot of work. I think the reality here is unity does not come without acknowledging the members of the party that have left. And we're talking about 85% of millennials, those under 36 years old, do not identify with the Democratic Party. So while Malcolm is a strong, loyal Democrat, you know, we have to acknowledge that there are people that do not feel like they were included. And just by virtue of the establishment candidate being supported, they need more than that, than just putting Keith Ellison on stage. You know, what I'm seeing on Twitter is that they think he was used as a prop. Only time will tell. A deputy chair, vice chairs, you know what? Every single position in the Democratic Party, except for chair and treasurer and finance chair, had no power. That's something to keep in mind. Up until this election. So the Democrats have a lot of work to do in empowering their DNC members, empowering their state parties so they can organize, empowering their rank and file Democrats, because it has been a party of throwing elaborate events, but not a party of inclusivity, open budgets, allocating resources for organizing. And that's how you lose a generation. If you don't engage with them, other than asking for money, you're going to lose a generation. So they have a lot of work to do.
I don't disagree with the need for more millennial. I don't disagree with a lot of the things that you said, but I think one of the issues is there is this impulse to throw around overly charged rhetorical bombs at people without looking at the record. Tom Perez is not,
for example,
talking about using the word establishment, which has been used as a hammer to hit people over the head with. If that's not your candidate. Tom Perez led, and actually, let's be clear. I thought Keith Ellison should have been the party chair, but I'm ready to move past that. Tom Perez has a strong, strong progressive record. And now is the time to say, what do we agree on? How can we move forward? And that's what you saw with Keith Ellison coming on stage. It's not about him being a prop. It's not about him being a prop.
What do Democrats agree on?
I think that we agree on understanding that politics, well, we should understand, that politics is ultimately about people. And real people in their real lives. And so when I think about the Democratic Party, and one of the reasons I am a Democrat, is that we're the only party, and you ask the Republicans, that is talking about raising wages, that's talking about unions' rights, that's talking about inclusivity. I mean, you had the first trans woman ever speak at the DNC. You have, when I looked at that picture, you asked for an instant reaction. I saw a direct repudiation of Donald Trump's agenda. The first Latino chair ever. The first Muslim American deputy chair ever. That's powerful. That's important. And I think Sam brought up a great point before we went back online, is that if this movement is not about justice for all, justice for everybody, then we are going to continue to have disagreements. This, for me, is not about partisan labels, establishment versus, this is about real people. And we lost a real big opportunity in this election when some people on the far, far, far left voted for Jill Stein or said that they were going to stay home. There were real people that were hurt because of that. And it's a mistake that I hope we don't make again.
I want to shift things just a little bit, because there is a conversation online about leadership and perhaps lack thereof. Mm-hmm. This is a tweet we got from Akash, who says, what's missing is the lack of a leader with Obama-esque appeal and story. So I'm wondering what you all think of that. Sam, I'll give that one to you, especially because you did run for DNC chair and you have people asking what you were going to do next. Are you looking at local level? Are you looking at national level? And are there other young or just fresh voices out there that you think aren't being heard?
So absolutely. That is exactly why I ran for DNC chair in the first place. The future of what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to get past this whole, the way the politics is currently played. The problem is, it is an insider's game. I mean, there is no argument against it. you either are a part of the party and part of the inner circle, or you don't get a say or have a voice in it. And we saw that with this race too. Not to say that I should have won and I'm guilty and angry and blah, blah, blah. No, whatever. That's irrelevant. I knew I wasn't going to win. But I did drive the conversation. I did drive the narrative. And I did get people to start talking about what mattered on the national stage, which is cool. Hey, I can pat myself on the back for that. But what we must focus on is that true leadership. I'm not saying I'm the guy. I'm not saying Malcolm's the guy. I'm not saying Tom Perez or Keith Ellison are the people. Maybe they are. Maybe they're not. It doesn't matter who the person is, so long as they focus on what matters most is people. And that's what I'm trying to do. The organization I'm trying to build, this whole, I mean, it sounds very metaphysical, very metaphorical, but we must come together. And if nobody else is bringing us together, like, for instance, Bernie Sanders, and I'm not even bringing it up for the divide. Bernie Sanders tapped into a populist movement the same way Trump did, except Trump's is still in existence because he's the current leader. Anyway, Bernie Sanders, when he stopped being the presidential candidate, his infrastructure, everything that he did, everything that he built, everything that all across the country was all things Bernie, stopped. There was no cohesiveness. There was no network. There was no infrastructure.
I don't agree with that. I don't agree with
there
that, actually.
There is a national movement, though.
No, there's several organizations out there. There's Brand New Congress.
There are several.
Our Revolution.
But they're all focusing on these little individual aspects of it rather than focusing on the...
No, that's not true, Sam. That's not true. The reality here is that there's an intersection between all these movements. I've interviewed people like Winnie Wong, who was a leader at the Women's March. She was a signatory on this on the Women's March. Linda Sarsour, who I've gotten to know very well through the Bernie campaign, was one of the organizers of the Women's March. They brought in so many different sections of activists who could unite under the principle of equality for women. And we're talking about union leaders, from the nurses to fundraisers.
They brought them into the Women's March and to like the individual things. We need to bring it all into one.
Well, maybe that's your opinion. I think a lot of people think that there's a new level, a new type of organizing, which is flat organizing, so that Black Lives Matter can support the right, the fight for 15, and they can show up for each other. Like I went and I covered a protest against Uber the other day, and you had immigration activists showing up, you had Fight for 15 activists showing up, you had the CWA union showing up. I think this is a moment where it doesn't have to be top down. It's about communicating with each other. And so these lists are shared. There's a really well-known activist named Becky Bond who wrote a book about this year, about people sharing lists, sharing communication. And it's not through the structures that we knew in the 20th century, but of a new wave of structures. And one thing I want to just point out, just to kind of like add in at the end here, is that Chairman Perez has talked about reforming the culture of the Democratic Party, which... Mm-hmm. After watching these forums, I think every candidate has talked about being more inclusive, being more open to activism, not talking about fundraising as much. But there is one problem, and I try to look at the root issues so you can address all these other stuff. There's one issue that remains in the DNC that I think is holding up bringing in these new leaders that can embrace and engage in the next generation, and that's conflicts of interest. The people who are the deciding members of the Democratic Party, almost half of them have contracts with the Democratic Party. So if they're not invested in changing the culture because they're actually receiving money based on the status quo, then you have a real issue. And there's an upcoming Unity Commission that's a rules commission that I think those issues will be addressed at, but most likely won't be solved because one of the chairs happens to have a contract with the DNC.
All right, Nomi, Sam, Malcolm, please come back again.
Absolutely.
Enjoyed having you here on the stream.
Thank you so much.
Malika.
I'll end with two tweets we got from people on how to move this forward, what should happen after this show. This is Gladiator News, who says, getting people to vote during midterms should be the focus. Energy from grassroots must be integrated into party strategy. She's on the optimistic side of that spectrum. Here's the not-so-optimistic side. This is someone who tweeted in, this is what should happen to the Democratic Party. And you can see a little gif there of it being blown up.
Golly.
And on that note, I will say goodbye. Thank you, guests. Thank you, community.
Thank you so much.
See you next time.